around. Today, we're going to be doing a fun solar and vibration-based engineering activity, thanks to the fun people at Nasco Education. There we go. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, please talk to Jordan, the other wonderful voice on this live stream. You can also email Jordan at engage@nascoeducation.com. He's very good at answering emails, I know, from lots of experience. But he has information on everything we have here. If you need resources or to gain access to the supplies we have, Nasco has access to all those things. And if you have other questions about the other wonderful live streaming work that other people besides us do with Nasco, you can talk to them there. And oh, I think we also have another fun overlay too. Pete, where can these fine folks find out more Nasco-centric information on social media? There we go. We came prepared. So if you like these workshops and want to see more fun, engaging activities and teacher resources, follow them on your social media of choice, Nasco Education. It's very easy to find. Yeah. Excellent. So we're going to do a fun activity. Today we're going to be doing a solar bug, which is a solar activity based around bugs. We're going to switch to the above camera right now. Yay. So the solar bug is a solar panel with a vibrating motor attached to it. It works very fun as a distance learning activity, as well as a just fun solar activity, a fun engaging activity, because it vibrates around and moves around on a table when sunlight hits the solar cell. Since we are inside and not outside in sunny Wisconsin today, it is not vibrating. You need actual sunlight, which is a big part of the lesson plan we have for this, because sun has many different wavelengths of light. There are many different types of light energy. The lights we have here are very different than incandescent lights or fluorescent lights, and very different from the sunlight. So our lesson plans have students using this simple activity as a measuring tool, using the vibrations coming out of here to measure different types of light, because solar panels use a very specific wavelength that does not get triggered very easily by LED lights or incandescent bulbs or flames, most artificial lights, unless you're using a calculator that is actually specifically built for taking energy from those little calculator solar cells everyone's always had. They work differently than this kind that you would find, say, on a roof of a building or in a solar farm or in camping gear. So we're gonna make this fun activity, show you how to do it and go over the activity and how we might wanna run that in a classroom. Now, before you ask me, because I know you wanna ask me, Josh, what age level is this appropriate for? Well, it's a good question, teacher out there. So we recommend grades 4 and up for all the activities that we do, mostly because of the dexterity involved and the following of directions. Not that you can't have third graders also easily accomplish this, depending on your group of third graders. We just find that ages 10 and up, which would be fourth grade and up, tend to have no problems whatsoever with this activity, and it can be very easily led by a single teacher in a classroom. Same thing with the lesson plans, very easy to implement with that age level. Again, dexterity and just the small-ish parts that we have on here that aren't that small. So let's get into this. Before I forget, this comes in several different kits because you can get the entire kit and caboodle from Nasco Education. You gotta throw that out there. Oh, there it is. Thanks, Pete. Yeah. Thanks, Pete. Pete's great. So we have a small version, which is a 4-pack here. And then there's also a larger classroom set, which has enough for 25 students worth. Additionally, besides the materials in here, the printed materials and directions that are in here, we also have additional bug templates, legs, wings, other bug-based fun printables that are available to use with these kits as well. So yay for the fun solar bucket. Everything you need is in here, to be honest, for the 4 and the 25 pack. That way all you need is a pair of scissors and some wonderful colored pencils to make this activity. So let's get down to it. So the solar bug is a vibration-based bot, meaning we use a vibrating motor, like this little guy right here, for movement. Frequently, people will see this in a simple bristle bot, which is another activity that we do frequently with Nasco, little toothbrush robot. This is kind of the go-to vibration bot that people do things with, little motor on and a battery on a toothbrush head to vibrate away and off the table. Instead, we're using a solar panel because that's way cooler and more 21st century, 21st century than a little vibrating motor on a toothbrush head. And because solar panels are really simple technology. Fun factoid, Thomas Edison used solar voltaic materials. You can go back and look at Thomas Edison patents and stuff where they treat copper and other metals with certain chemicals to get a reaction from sunlight. So solar energy has been used and has been known for quite a long time. not just plants, but also Thomas Edison. More useful these days because we have mass production, very efficient solar cells that are very inexpensive to put on homes and buildings. And something like this, again, very easy and exactly the same kind of technology you'll find on a rooftop. It's a little 2-volt solar panel, if you're wondering, and we use these little self-sticking motors, which vibrate quite well on that. So let's make this little guy. So first and foremost, you want to get your little build guide, which comes in the kit. Oh, there we go, front side. Build guide. We also have a bigger printable and a video as well to show off. Actually, by the way, Pete, do we have a video of these in action somewhere?
Yeah, would you like to see it?
I would love to show the fine folks out there of a video of these in action. So we, yeah, sure.
Okay. You want to be muted or unmuted?
Leave me unmuted.
I will unmute you now.
Actually, let's just stop it. There you go. Just join. There we go.
Stop it there.
Yeah, we'll stop. Go back to the other thing. I'm not sure if audio is working through to the software correctly from our live streaming software to the video presentation software in Nasco. But you can see it, they rotate around a table pretty well outside in decent sunlight. It didn't have to be bright sunlight, just decent sunlight. They'll trigger and move around pretty well. So let's get making one of these little guys today. Use a little build guide, either this or the printed version or the rest of that video, which is a full build guide, about 2 minutes worth. You want to find this here, get your materials, really scissors and colored pencils. You want to add extra wings and legs to things, some extra glue, some tape, whatever works. And you're going to need a template. Now our kits come in a variety of templates. We got a little ladybug right here. We also got stag beetle on the backside. We've got several others come in our different kits and other things that we have templates made up. Just make sure you're using at least 30-pound cardstock when doing this. 30-pound cardstock is heavy enough to be useful, but yet not so heavy it jams up your printer in your school. Interesting thing to know. 30-pound is a nice middle ground. We use a little bit thicker than that in the printables we have in the kits. And these come in those kits. So first and foremost, you want to make sure you grab your colored pencils like this, and you want to take your ladybug, and you want to have kids do the decorating before they build the rest of it. Oh yeah, so I'm just going to do this. So there we go. See,
good coloring.
I know, I'm really good at this. As a middle school science teacher, I was known for my intense use of colors in the classroom. Which I can't recognize because I am colorblind. Fun fact, I'm not allowed to dress myself for formal events in my household.
I'm sure it's a fun fact, but it's a fact.
I have to get approved by my spouse. Because I have had way too many outfits like that, does not work. I'm going to push these out to the side, these two colors I have there. Color blindness, fun for everyone.
Science.
Then you want to cut these out. Now, this is like the hardest part of the activity is cutting out your bug. I'm going to do a half-hearted job because I'm on camera. And again, that's why we always have the printables available. So if people want to, say, use a lot of one type over another or make multiple ladybugs, they totally can. That's why we have printables and legs and wings and other things. We had a teacher on Twitter post, she made a bunch of crabs, like decapods. That's right, crabs are decapods because they have 10 legs. Science words. Did that with a bunch of her students, which was really fun to see because no one picks the crab. All the photos we ever get from teachers, ladybugs, stag beetles, maybe a stink bug every now and then. No one ever chooses the crab, which is sad. It's a pretty fun thing. Decapods, they're great. So there's your fun bug body. Yay. We're going to put him to the side. We're going to grab the couple of things that you will need to make this. You're going to need our vibrating motor, going to need your solar panel, and you're going to need some of our conductive tape, which I totally also stuck outside my range of reaching. Let's see if I can find it. I'm doing great. I moved to the side because like we don't need conductive tape, and we totally do. Off to the side there, Pete. Thanks. Any of that, there we go. This is what I was looking for, a strip of our conductive tape. This is our awesome maker tape. It's a nylon conductive tape. So none of that copper foil stuff you might have seen other people use over the years. Maker tape, yes. It's nylon, so it's nice and sturdy and strong. It's conductive on top and bottom. And we put way too much of it into our kits because there'll be a lot left over because they come in good sized rolls when we get them made up. Hey, Pete, do you have a graphic that shows how much I dislike copper foil tape?
We have a graphic and we have a video.
Oh wow, that's production value right there. We have hit it big.
Yes.
But no, this is great stuff. We use a lot with paper circuits kits and doing even Arduino and microbit projects with this fun tape on paper, cardboard, windows, walls, and even fabric. Fabric tape works really well on, oddly enough, fabric. But we only need a couple little chunks of this to attach things together. This makes the project entirely non-soldering. Everything just goes together very easily. Now from here, you want to attach these two little wires. The might be a little hard to see on this camera overhead, but we've got a big area of exposed wire on the end of here on the red and the blue. We need to attach those to these two little points in the middle right here. They either put the motor right in the middle here or the motor up here. It doesn't matter. What matters is hooking up those two little wires to those two spots. So I'm actually going to go up to the center area up here on our little custom-made solar cell.
Oh, that's like 30 by 60 millimeters?
It is. How did you know, Pete?
Yeah.
You guessed. Now, this is, it doesn't matter where we put the motor. These wire leads are long enough to reach those two spots from basically anywhere in the solar panel, which is why we have extra long wire leads on here. So I'm just going to put it down. These are self-sticking motors. Peel off the back and stick them down. We use them all the time for vibration-based paper crafts because they stick to lots of stuff. They're also not so strong they'll take drywall off, which is good. That nice middle ground between tearing off drywall and being stuck to your window forever and then not being sticky enough.
Do we have a tape that'll tear off drywall?
We actually do, and that's what we'll be using next when we get there. So just got to position them in place. Then we're just going to cut a couple little pieces of our tape here. You need like a quarter of an inch, two little quarter of inch spots. Like really, you don't need very much. We have way too much in our kits. In fact, actually, I should probably, to make life easier, I'll unpeel and then cut. Unpeel first. It's like eating an orange.
Right.
Unpeel first, then eat. Yeah. That's the order of operations. If you go the other way around, it's not fun. We've all been there. Take a big old bite of that orange with the peel on.
So maker tape, right?
Maker tape. There's no TM at the end of that. So the tape is conductive on top and bottom, which is why we use it to stick it down. And as long as the tape and the wire, like all three things are touching somewhere along the way, you're good. Ta-da. There we go. We do that twice and we're good. This activity works really well as a distance learning tool for kids because it's so darn simple to put together and you can use it through a window, go outside, which by the way is always good for everybody, even here in balmy Wisconsin, where it's a high of 41 today in the greater Milwaukee area. Maybe a little bit warmer by the lake, as they always say. There we go. Electronically, you are good to go. I always have students then go and test this setup right away through a window. If you have a nice sunny window in your classroom, or take a little jaunt outside and say, hey, does it vibrate? Does it work? It will. It's really hard to do this wrong, which is why we like it. It would be like, it'd be nice little, you hear something, you feel something, it's good. But right now, it's kind of, I would say it's kind of boring, Pete. It is kind of boring, just solar panel to motor on there. So what we're going to do is we're going to take some of this tape, which is the foam tape we have, which is now, of course, sticking to me because this is really, this will take off drywall. It's good stuff. Then just take a piece of the foam tape you have, stick it on the back of here, and we just stick this entire contraption to the nicely shaped rectangle in the middle, like so. And look at that. It's a perfect fit. Yay. Which is why I want to color ahead of time. Once you've put everything together, it's really awkward to color. This also a little layer of protective layer of stuff on the top of the solar panel. You can either take off or leave on. It doesn't really matter. It still works quite well. And these will work just fine through a window, unless you have a really, really, really fancy like UV treated window, like a really nice one. And sometimes it'll actually block out the rays you need. That's a fun customer service phone call. Like, open up the window, try that. There you go.
What about stained glass windows?
Stained glass windows. Well, those are just fun for everybody. I don't care if you're a 14th century monk or a 21st century art student. They're fun for everyone. Okay. Stained glass is pretty cool. So as it is right now, actually we'll have a very hard time moving. So we need to add one last thing to this mix to add both sound and motion in a fun setting. We use self-sticking googly eyes. Oh yes, they actually act as casters. They're nice and smooth on the bottom, have very little surface contact, and make things move much, much easier. It also adds a nice little rattle to everything. And as a former educator, I love when I get kinesthetics, visual, and auditory feedback on a project. And a little bit of rattle adds a lot of fun to something that's rather simple. So three or four of these self-sticking googly eyes does the job, because they might slightly rattle. You just take it outside, any smooth surface, like a tabletop or a piece of plastic, acrylic, works well to have these move on. The smoother the better, tends to work well. I can do this. All the videos we post have them on a piece of just plastic we have, a little piece of hard acrylic, scrap piece of acrylic, actually. So two or three, it doesn't matter. We actually tried many, many, many variations of like where to put the eyes, how many to use, and in the end, we're just, it doesn't matter. As long as you have three or four on there, they all tend to move about the same. But then you're good. You get a nice little rattly feedback, sound, and light. So let's talk about the lesson plan then in the next 7 minutes we have here to chat. There you go. Two bug and a bug. They can fight. Battle bugs. Like very poor maracas, if I can get that. Not tambourines, but anyway, maracas. So as they are right now, they're great little fun activities. Kids can do stuff. But in the classroom, you actually want to have the kids do a lesson and activity with this. So as I mentioned before, they don't really work well with artificial forms of light. We have these big LED lights on us. We have fluorescent lights in our office. Even a halogen light somewhere around here we tried things on. They all are very poor emitters of the right type of light spectrum to get solar panels going. The chemical reaction that actually happens when light hits these solar voltaic crystals. So what we have students do in our lesson plan is try out different types of light sources in the classroom with a ruler next to them. How far away do you have to be from the incandescent bulb, from the LED light, from the compact fluorescent? If you want to get really fancy, a flame, an open flame in your classroom. That's a fun one for slightly older students. And I would just say in general, whatever lights you have around your home or classroom, bring some lights and have different stations around to have the students try things down. And then just have a ruler, okay, at 4 inches, does it move? 3 inches, 2 inches, like, or whatever amount of spacing you want for data collection. Because that's the thing, you can collect data from a lot of different sources. And the nice part is, some of the things like incandescent bulbs and especially halogen, if you get pretty close, they will trigger. You have to be pretty darn close to it, and it'll be just barely trigger the motor. Just enough voltage and amperage out of that to just get it going a little bit. But you can use your body to feel that when that triggering happens, is it a little bit of vibration or heavy vibration? Where does it go compared to other light sources? Now, again, taking one form of data collection is fine, but if you're a fun science teacher like I was, you want to collect more than one data point. So we also have the kids use their eyes and their hands again to test out heat and visible light. Which is the brightest thing? How bright is it from a scale of like, ouch, it hurts my eyes, to I'm in the dark, where are you? Or comparing the different light sources, which is the brightest, labeling them from, you know, top to bottom, putting them in order of brightness to dimness in the classroom. Same thing with heat, which is the hottest, which is the coolest. Because for a lot of kids, they equate light with heat. And that's a common misconception that students and even adults will make. Because I know here in Wisconsin, it could be very bright out in the winter, but freaking cold out, because we're here in Wisconsin in the winter in February. However, there's still a lot of solar energy hitting us, just not the thermal aspect of it. Good factoid, some of the best days for solar collection in Wisconsin are in February. Do you know that, Pete?
I did. I talked to Ben.
Oh, yeah, Ben, who's actually our video guy, who's next room over from here. He gets a bunch of solar panels, and he gets great chunks of energy from his solar panels on his garage because it's so clear here in Wisconsin. Even though the day's a bit shorter, but it's just so darn clear. And again, of course, it's also overcast the other half of the month, but it gets great power collection. Germany actually is a big solar producer, and they're at the same basic latitude as we are in the world, Germany. And they're, yeah, Wisconsin. It's weird, fun solar stuff you learn over the years when doing solar activities. So have the kids compare those three things. Brightness, heat, and then the vibration aspect. And always make sure one light source is, of course, the sun. Because when you say, okay, I'm a half an inch away from the halogen lamp I have, it's really hot, it's rather bright, and it's just barely triggering this motor. Let's compare to the sun. Pete, how far away is the sun?
One sunlight unit.
Ooh. Like 7 minutes at light speed. Is it one AU? One astronomical unit, which is the distance from the Earth to the sun. No, it's like 96 million miles away, give or take, depending on where it is in the elliptical orbit. Ah, that's the right answer. Science. I was that science teacher. But that's a very far ways away. That's why it looks so small up in there in the sky. But you can say, okay, it's triggering even though it's so far away. And again, comparison, especially for the younger kids, your fourth, fifth, sixth graders, it's really great body interaction, body kinesthetics, using you as the sensor and then comparing different light sources. Now, if you want to get super, super fancy, say like middle school kids, you can take different translucent materials such as sunglasses or transparent film with, say, sunscreen sphered over the top of it, to then put them over your solar bug and see if that changes how much it vibrates. Fun fact, it will. Especially get some like nice big cheap sunglasses. That's a contradictory term, nice big cheap. But that block UV, yeah, light comes through, but it's not triggering anymore. It doesn't take much light to get these guys going. If you can, try to do your activity in a nice bright sunny day, which, you know, we can easily predict. But they do trigger pretty well even on like a hazy or overcast day. Especially if you try to do things more towards noontime, if you're able to do that. But we had some good success even on overcast days with getting these guys to trigger and do silly things. So that's the solar bug and some of the lesson plans, which we have written out with the worksheets and information. It's pretty much the easiest, lowest cost solar activity you can do for a classroom that isn't just solar panel with a motor attached, like little fan. That's kind of the go-to thing, a solar panel with a fan attached, which is literally a motor. With a fan on there, that's kind of boring. It is really boring, but it's a go-to thing because it's easy to do, easy to understand, easy to implement. This is a bit different, same basic idea, but then using it for data collection, data comparison, and interaction with light sources, because knowing different types of light is important. Because LEDs are great, they're really nice and bright, but they're cold, especially the LEDs we use. You get some big industrial ones, they get rather warm, but like these LEDs here, or the one on the back of your phone that you use as a flashlight every now and then, they don't get warm. Incandescent bulbs do, they're very inefficient, more heat than light. So we can talk about, yeah, different types of light sources and how we interact with them, why we use one over the other, and why the sun is the best of all. It's great. It's a gigantic ball of plasma.
Like this.
It is. Anyway, so that's the solar bug activity. Nasco has them in the 4-pack and 25. They're nice. They're very cost-effective to send home and use in the classroom. And the goal is to send them home with kids. You want them to make the bug, have their own bug design, and they take them home when they're done. It's theirs. It's a fun thing to take home. There's nothing dangerous in here to send home with the kids. And it'll last forever because it's powered by the sun. It's a fun thing to show off for the kids to their family members and explain how it works. But it's a great make and take with a purpose. So there we go. Exactly 25 minutes. I would say, Jordan, if you're out there, has anybody asked any interesting questions in the chat window? Because we're happy to answer some fun chat questions if you have any fun teachers out there.
Yeah, thanks, Josh. Yeah, so right now what I'm doing in the background while Josh has been presenting is getting the files in for the handouts ready. So I've been kind of doing that a little bit. I'm not quite done with that just yet, which is okay. I'm looking really quickly at the questions tab. I'm not seeing anything right now. Is there anything that you want to add, Josh, as far as any supplement activities that you want to do with this in the classroom or maybe starters, things of that, while I'm trying to finalize these last couple worksheets?
Sure. Another fun thing to talk about with this as well is using the vibration-based aspect to talk about motion. We do that with our BristleBots, which vibrated off the table earlier and is now on the floor somewhere vibrating loudly. It's very fun to talk about locomotion with a simple concept of a vibrating motor, because honestly, a vibrating motor is one of the most inefficient forms of locomotion you can do, but it works pretty darn well. And you can talk about, could we change the different materials on the bottom or even use different materials on the bottom up here to see if that changes the way they move and how motion affects them. That's a fun thing to do because especially insects use a lot of different types of locomotion to get around, which is why they're so interesting, all those little hexapods, because they have six legs. I know, science terms. But you can talk about motion as a good way of doing things. I have some teachers use these literally with their bug-based activities because it is a fun bug aspect you can talk about and mix and match components around. I do like insect motion, again, I mentioned fun motion of like simple creatures. There's really interesting ways that they get locomotion from very simple movements. And this is a way, one way you could possibly do things. We'll say, clams, they stick a big tongue out there and move around. The clams are my favorite. They have the most whimsical type of movement for invertebrates go. Mollusks, never cross a mollusk. That's good advice. But the solar aspect of this is the big selling point for these, the big use case in a classroom. Going back to that mention before, using different types of materials to go over the top to change light coming in, there's a lot of good information out there. I can't think of the top of my head. I have a spreadsheet somewhere of some different good videos on YouTube and good articles written online that talk about different types of common materials and how they block sunlight. If you can, grab some things like cheap sunglasses, some tint film material, saran wrap that has some sunscreen over the top of it, anything that's designed to block light. And if you can't even find like an old shirt that's UV treated, I know those were quite the rage a while ago for sporting goods things. We have a one you're okay parting with, put over the top. And even glass as well. If you can find a piece of UV treated glass, ages ago, we used to use a different solar panel on these guys. Actually, this is an old one because it's a slightly different solar panel than this, the new ones we use. These are a little bit better than the old ones we had, and they trigger much easier through UV treated glass. But every now and then, if you put a couple layers of that together, it will block out the useful parts of the spectrum to say, hey, you know, that's why we have this nice glass, so I'm not getting a sunburn or getting skin damage from the sun by sitting in the window. You gotta watch out, cats with white fur get skin cancer, I'm told. So you shouldn't let them sit in the sun, which seems contradictory to what a cat does. They have fun in the sun, but that's a legitimate thing. That's why we have UV treated windows now to help prevent any sort of damage to our skin just passively. This car's been doing that for quite a while because people tend to get a lot of sunlight when driving. So that's another good pointer too. So if any questions, now's the time to ask. Otherwise, I'm tapped out for fun knowledge today.
Well, thank you, Josh. I definitely appreciate it. Yeah, so I'm not seeing any questions right now, but that's not to say that there might be some later. I wanted to say thanks for everyone for joining us today. And thank you, Josh, for presenting. My name is Jordan Nelson. I'm one of the customer engagement managers with Nasco. I was your host today.